This video will show how to make Irish Uilleann pipe chanter reeds from contrabassoon cane, French contrabassoon cane. You can see here, this is the normal bassoon cane or bagpipe tube cane that we often use for making chanter reeds. Contrabassoon cane is a little bit wider, as you can see here looking at the end. As you can see, the diameter is 26 to 28 millimeters, a bit over 1 inch in diameter, larger than the usually 1 inch or slightly less diameter Spanish and wild California cane many people use for the Uilleann pipes. We'll split the cane in the usual way to the usual width that you would make for your particular chanter. And we'll gouge it in the usual way. We may want to use a slightly shallower gouge with a little bit less curvature than we use for narrower cane. And then we'll sand the slip to the desired width in the usual way, same dimensions as I would use for narrower cane. For my chanters, I like to be very slightly over 1/2 inch width. Then we're going to finish the gouged surface by sanding to a sanding cylinder, and this cylinder is wider than the common 2-inch cylinder that we use for narrower cane. I like to go at about 2 1/4 inches or so, over 55-56 millimeter diameter cylinder. And we'll finish off the interior surface with nice fine sandpaper for a very smooth finish. Now, French cane has a harder bark than Spanish cane or wild California, and because of that, we don't want to make our edges as thin as knife edge. That bark is very hard, and to get the right flexibility at the finished reed, we may need to take more bark off the sides than we do with other types of cane. So I always leave my edges just a little bit thick. And you can see on the diagram it indicates roughly what I'm aiming for my edges. And since French cane is harder than Spanish cane and wild cane, I like to let my strips of cane, after they're prepared for slips, rest in a small box or Tupperware container with a little bit of water inside a little lid inside the box there to create high humidity, and I'll put it with the finished side down so I don't get any drips on it. This will soften the cane. The humidity inside a closed box will be nearly 100%, and I'll let that sit for 24 hours and become nice and humid and softened. French cane deforms much less readily than other canes, and so it seems to me, in my experience, it works better if we work with it a little more humidified, heavily humidified. And then the benefit of the French cane after we've put it into service is that resistance to deformation will help the reed resist getting a shape we don't want once we've got it fine-tuned and in playing service. All right, I've removed the cane from the humidifier, cut the tails to shape, cut the slip in half to make two blades, and I bound them together, and here's my staple tube that I'm going to mount into it. With this humidified cane, I like to bind the entire head of the reed up in advance. The cane is soft enough that we can just push the staple up into the reed. The blades will always be together at the edges all the way along, and there's not much risk of splitting cane that's been humidified like this. And I'll check my length that I need for my particular chanter, and then I'll go ahead, add a drop of super glue to each side to hold it in place, and then bind up the reed. I'm binding the reed right now, and since the cane is soft and humid, I can pull these bindings pretty tight with a significant amount of force that I'd be afraid to do if I was using dry cane. You see the edges have already come together. Another reason to use tight binding at this stage is that the cane is swollen a little from the humidity, and it will shrink and loosen that binding as the reed dries out. I like to use this artificial sinew wide waxed ribbon because it goes very quickly, and I'm mostly interested in a reed that works rather than one that has beautiful artistry of hundreds and hundreds of wraps of fine thread. So now the entire reed, the edges are together all the way along at the head. It's tightly bound, and you can see the lips have a relatively low elevation, a fairly narrow opening. With this humidified method, though, we're going to try to decrease that opening. We want the finished reed to end up almost closed in plain geometry even before we start scraping it, because that way the cane will be in a maximum relaxed state when we scrape it, and it'll vibrate freely, and it'll be mostly finished settling before we ever even make the reed. All right, in the center of the blade I've put 5 or 6 wraps of soft copper wire, and I've squeezed that wrapping to close the lips down to just about exactly the amount of opening that I would have for a reed if it was in plain condition, all scraped and ready to use in the chanter. Maybe very slightly more open. By doing this in the middle of the blade, if the blades should try to open too much more at the top, we can take this bridle and slide it down, and that will help squeeze the blades closed as it settles later on. And if they start to close up too much, I can move the bridle towards the open end of the reed, and that'll open it back up, and I can make sure that it settles for a long time at just the amount of opening that I want. I'm now going to let this reed rest back in the humidity box for several hours. Then I'll take it out and I'll let it sit overnight in room air to dry gently. And the reed should now be given another complete cycle of 12 to 24 hours in high humidity and another 12 to 24 hours in dry air. In fact, before you scrape the reed, there should be at least 2 cycles of humidity and dry, and the last cycle of dry should be a solid 24 hours or more in ordinary room air before you cut into it. The reed has now rested in very dry air, and if you look here, you can see that the lips are mostly closed as they are in a playing elevation. And I've kept the edges bound together while it was drying so that the whole reed should be very nicely held together but not under a lot of tension when I release all of the bindings and the bridle and begin to scrape the reed. With the binding removed, you can see that a very gentle pressure will separate the blades at the edges, which is what we want. It'll be easy to hold them together, but we don't want edges that are very tightly sprung together because that will harm the response of the reed. Okay, I've done my rough scraping of the reed. I've just cut it down a little bit with a razor blade, and you can see the lips are pretty thick still, and I'll take a quick sand on some sandpaper to smooth that up, and then we'll take our first listen to the reed. Okay, I have quickly sanded the reed, and if we look at the end, you can see that it's opened up very slightly. It's opened up a little wider than we like for playing. I'm going to put the bridle on it, and we'll take a first listen. If you notice, if you can see the end clearly there, it's still a little bit thick compared to what you normally expect for reeds, and we leave them a little thick at this stage because we may need to adjust the inside surface depending on how smoothly the cane formed up. Okay, I've got the reed bridled, and I've got it wrapped on the bottom with thread, and you can see I've got it set down to playing elevation at this point, almost closed. I'm going to inhale through the bass, and we'll see what it sounds like. That's a pretty conventional sound for a concert D reed, so I'll stick it in the head of my Chanter, and we'll just give it a first quick blow. That's a very good sound for a freshly scraped reed. It's a little bit hard to blow, just a little bit, because of the thick cane. It's just very slightly soft in the tone, and that's going to be because there's some microscopic warping on the inside of the blades. I'm going to let this reed sit for a day and just let it settle in its new condition, and we'll return and examine the inside and show how to get a little more brightness out of the sound. The reed has now sat for a day, and before I take it apart to examine the interior to find out why the tone is a little bit dull, I've moved the bridle up about a third of the way, and then I re-squeezed it so that the lips are just like I like them for playing. Nice, easy playing strength. Reason I did that is I'm going to use flame heat to melt the wax on the binding here, and that will in turn heat the cane underneath, and it'll give a permanent set to the tails of the reed in just the position they're in now, so I can take it apart and put it back together, and I won't be changing the tension in any way on the reed. And the heat may extend up here very short distance. You have to be careful not to heat the open chamber of the reed there, because the heat will cause it to collapse, and your reed will go way sharp in the first octave, and you'll lose important tuning. But we do have to heat the entire binding, and the staple comes right up to the top of the binding, so it's all supported through here. So I'll heat the staple just a little bit, and then I'll rotate, and you may see the binding begin to look a little bit moist as the wax melts. I don't know if the camera will show that. And I'm moving it up close to the top of the binding, and I'm watching the binding at the very top starting to get glistening and moist. I'll come back down again and make sure that's good and wet from the wax that's on there. And that's all it takes, and I'm going to have to rest this for about 10 minutes, let it cool thoroughly before I try taking the reed apart. Alright, I've got the elevation right at the way I like it for playing, and the reed is now cooled off. So we'll take it apart and we'll look at the inside to see if we can find any trouble in there. Here you can see the rotation moving the shadow down. I'm afraid the camera is not clear enough in video, so I'll use a diagram or photo to illustrate it. But there is some irregular light movement at the two corners, which illustrate that they've bent slightly outwards. Very slight amount. It's hardly visible unless you use magnifying glass. But that's enough to affect the tone, and it's very easy to fix. I have here a set of cylinders from about 3 to 5 or 6 inches or more in diameter, made from pieces of plumbing pipe, and one of these will have a wide enough curve that will be just equal to the curve at the very tip end of the reed, and we'll use that to restore a nice, perfectly smooth, uniform curve without taking much cane away. I laid the blade on several cylinders and looked at the fit from the end view, and it was my conclusion that a 4-inch cylinder fit the curve very nicely, so I'm just going to put some fine sandpaper on it, very fine sandpaper, and I'm just going to sand it a very small amount, and I'll check it myself under the light after I brush the dust off it. And this reed was so close to perfect that it took nothing for that first blade. Now this blade had a little more warping. I'm not pressing very hard. And that's all it needed, just removing a tiny amount of dust. So I'll bind the reed back together again, and we'll give it another test. Now in binding the reed up for a second time, this time I don't want to pull it very tight, because that's going to tend to curl the cane and open the lips too far. So I'm pressing the binding down against the cane to make sure that it's snug, but you can see the edges have already come together, so I really don't need a lot of tension. Ideally, the reed should finish up, and I don't know if you can get the focus on this or not, but it's just right back at playing elevation. Nothing's changed, and that's a sign of a reed that's going to be very stable. So let's test it in the chanter. So that's a really good sounding reed. Tunes nice. And the bridle can adjust it to be stronger or easier. We can always take a little more cane off the blades later if we feel it's consistently running a little strong. But hopefully the California cane, which is naturally a little more stable against humidity, plus the humidity cycling of the blades and the heat treatment of the tail bindings, will make this reed very much more stable than a reed that's just made in the traditional fashion, straight from entirely dry process. You saw that I could take it apart and put it back together and the elevation didn't change, and that's a recipe, that's a sign that this is a reed that's going to be very dependable.